Kasi, you explained the crisis and took us to the climax of the crisis when everybody was stuck, and then your company, you had internally discussed and learned a lesson that, like, hey, this may not be the best way to do this soybean business. So what were the resolutions? What are the solutions that were options available, and what were you guys how are you evaluating them, and what are the ones that you are picking and choosing to
So
go ahead with?
it was a time of a lot of reflections within the company at the desk as to what has gone wrong, what could go wrong, what should be done that we don't go wrong again and again. We can't make the same mistake again and again if this
True.
looked like a mistake now, right? So it was something that was waiting to happen, and the markets colluded in a way at that point in time. So we said, what are we doing? We are trying to be at arm's length to the Chinese market by not being on the ground. And you can't blame us for that, nor anybody else for that matter. China was in WTO only for 3 to 4 years by then.
Right.
So a lot of institutions, trading sort of mentality, the psychology, the ecosystem is getting built up in the country in a way. So
Right.
People were not ready to jump in so quickly. Now, this at once presented an opportunity to us simply because we also had the fate of a vessel to be settled.
Right.
That was already at Hong Kong waiting for something to be done. Now, there was all options, all windows closed, really, in a way. And so, in the meantime, as the vessel was even steaming towards Hong Kong, we already started thinking as to I was clear in my mind that at some point this means we have to have a deeper engagement with China on a local basis. It's no longer just at arm's length, selling to a third party and taking your money and forgetting about it. So we already started moving some levers within the company and tried to figure out what is it that we can do. And we identified in the meantime a processing plant in Guangdong, in the province of Guangdong, in a city, in a town called Zhanjiang. So we started talking to them and saying it's a company that is a small company and not very well capitalized, obviously. So we started talking to them about possibility of toll crushing with them. So we take the whole plant on tolling basis and we run the plant. So as this was simultaneously going on, we were preparing the grounds to get an import permit because now we blacklist, now we are just out of blacklist, so we need to get an import permit. So luckily we had a JV, a joint venture partnership with local provincial COFCO for a long time, which we were using time to time for various things, but this time it came in very handy. And we had a trading company that was listed also in Shanghai. So we used the COFCO joint venture to be as a partner to get in the imports so that they
Right.
bring in their name, it can come into the country first.
Right.
And then the trading company will take over that and then give it to the plant.
Right.
And the trading company will manage the tolling arrangement. So
Correct.
that's how we made a tripartite kind of a deal. Put these things in place. And then we went up and got our approvals from the management because management obviously was also very shaken up by then. And so we said, this is one way because the alternative is we have to keep waiting for someone to turn up to buy this cargo and we don't know how long this will take.
Correct.
And in the market, if you go out to sell straight away, we are looking at booking $2-2.5 million loss straight on the ship. So we said, how do we now turn this around? It's a loss, but there should be a lesson to learn from here. And
Sure.
there is a way out from here. So that's how we finally got the approval from the management also to do this operation. And then we had a whole team set up in the meantime. So we were moving a lot of pieces on the chessboard. We went, we had, at that point, we also had a processing operation in India.
Right.
So I went and tapped our technical guys in India because now obviously if you're now operating for the first time in China and you don't know what kind of people you're getting, plus the fact that you may not be able to communicate with them.
Correct.
So we had to have our technical guy managing the production side. So we got on deputation the technical head of India to sit in this plant for 3 to 4 months. So we had to make sure the visa and all those are arranged. So we got them in, and eventually we did get the ship to discharge at Zhangjiang port. Luckily, because it was now fully in our control, we did manage to discharge the ship without too much of a problem. Took the beans in to the plant. Now, this meant several things. You are going to test the market for the first time yourself. Till now, correct, you never bothered about what happened to your beans. Once you ship discharged and gone, you don't care about what happened. Now, this game starts actually from there.
So yeah, you mentioned VUCA, right? In one of the VUCA strategies or under uncertainty is do some experimentation. And experimentation, the results are not guaranteed, but at least you will start getting information which you didn't have, right? And uncertainty is lack of information. And then you start getting information which you need to understand, and then you start navigating your way. So this is perfectly an example of that, right? Illustration of that.
So what happens in beans, soybean market normally for a country like China is that you buy the beans and hedge it on Chicago Board of Trade. So the suppliers will pass it through Chicago Board of Trade for pricing purposes. So your beans are fixed on Chicago Board of Trade. But then when you produce the meal and the oil, you can't go back to Chicago Board because this is China now. So you go to Dalian Commodity Exchange. So it meant that we need to understand how even the domestic hedging works.
Right.
And accounts have to be in place.
Correct. Right?
So, and how do the buyers even look at pricing it? I mean, what do they look in Dalian? How will that correlate with what you're physically selling in a place like Zhangjiang?
Right.
Do you need to do trucking? Do you need to put it on a rail?
Right.
Will you sell it FOT free on truck, or will you sell it delivered?
Yeah.
Shortages. So you got into a whole lot of new issues
indeed.
Nitty gritties of how you actually run. What happens to shortages when you are producing? Are you producing 98% of what you gave? Are you producing 97? Who's paying for the loss? And so we had to have a proper drafted toll agreement in the first place. And from then on to safety and security of your cargo, processing, losses, and then actually shipping it, selling it, shipping it, and getting the money back.
Correct.
And then it takes the whole route back. So
every headache that you avoided as a trader is all yours now.
Exactly. So, but it was a great learning experience because this forced us to literally go into the country now. And this is fairly early in the game, 2004. We're just 2-3 years of pickup in the bean imports happening. So we really went studying every point in that whole supply chain. We kept a whole team there. It took us almost 4 months or 5 months to complete this whole operation. By end of 2004, early 2005, we could finally put all the numbers together.
Okay.
And then we said, okay, what are the learnings? So we had to wrap up the whole thing and say, okay, now are we going to repeat this or not?
So what were the long-term benefits then?
Yeah. So what did that teach us? That we have the capability, if given the choice, we can actually scale this up into something bigger.
Right.
But then we'll avoid us selling to third parties. Now we cannot keep selling to third parties and expect different results. Keep doing the same, but expect different results. That's not going to happen. Markets can be volatile and will tend to be volatile. And so then we get actually into the market, and this is a growing market. And now we establish a place for ourselves with all our systems, the way we want to be structured, and the way we want everything to be controlled. So net, by the time we put in all our numbers together, this business of doing the tolling and everything together netted us somewhere around $1 million. So what would have been a $2 million loss turned out to be $1 million profit. So that swung the whole business by about $3 million, literally. Now that's not a bad thing to happen at all when you are completely stuck like this. And now on top of it, apart from making money, which is not losing, but at least getting back the money and making some, you also made sure you learned lessons. Now you opened up a new vista altogether. Now you opened up China as a market for yourself, for your company.
Right.
And you are not claiming this on paper. You are saying this is exactly how we actually went through it. And these are the learnings that we have. And how do we even go about planning for the next stages or next steps in our journey in China?
Right.
So that itself was to us a great satisfaction, actually, by the time we got into 2005. And that also told us that, yes, this is something, at least we are resolving a situation, because you can't say that, well, we had a bad issue, bad problem, and so we can't go into this country. No, this is not going to happen, because this
right.
is the future. This is the biggest, going to be the biggest importer, and this is going to be the biggest processor domestically. It is the biggest market eventually in the world of soybeans. And there's nobody else that is anywhere near this country. So we literally had to turn the whole argument around and got into doing this fairly well. That sort of set the stage.
So you understood, you sort of started understanding the China market, how the business operates, what are the various costs, elements of costs, and, you know, where were the possible bottlenecks, what were the, you know, challenges to be expected. And you had run through one process and, you know, so you knew more the system much better. So you understood the market. So, but you also said that it was all the you know, the import problem, the pink beans, the cargo getting stuck was, you know, industry-wide problem from all the major trading companies or the major suppliers were concerned. So how did other competitors react to this situation?
Right. So each one had their own way of rationalizing the whole situation.
Right.
Invariably, a lot of them also, because let's imagine that most of grain business is really run by Western multinationals.
Right.
Western grain houses, let's put it that way. So they have a fairly contractual kind of approach to business.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the approach a lot of times was that, okay, we got into this mess, we had these problems, but now we also make sure we go after the guys.
Mm.
So there were lots of arbitration cases, mm-hmm. both onshore and in Hong Kong.
Right.
Those are the only two possibilities really at that time. You could not go to GAFTA or FOSFA or whatever, mostly to be settled in that jurisdiction. So the arbitration centers in Hong Kong and Shanghai and Beijing, they got very busy for the next 3-5 years.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of shipping related issues became massively problematic because stuck between the ship owners and because some ships even got arrested onshore. So there were a whole lot of very ticklish issues. The competition, some of them took the approach of taking it contractual, going for arbitration cases, legal cases, whatever. And some, that was this sort of green shoots also in some of the organizations to say that maybe we should actually look at now going onshore. So it took a bit of time, but I think if subsequently and you look at it, we went in the next year in a different way. That's a whole story by itself. But we did realize that I think one other competitor also came in and picked up a plant from somebody else, just a little ahead of us. But then the others followed much later. So in the meantime, the Chinese government also was considering whether they should even open up this particular sector to foreign investment in 100% basis.
Okay.
So subsequently, there were restrictions coming in. All that happened. But this is a later stage. So net, I would say that the industry was shaken up. Industry picked up a lot of losses from this. And so a lot of major players stayed away from China for a good part of 2005, maybe even 2006.
And you guys chose to stay on, right?
We stayed away too in terms of selling third parties.
Correct.
And we did the tolling.
But you invested in the country.
Later, as we went along. That was the way out of that impasse in a way. So the bigger advantage also that I forgot to mention earlier was that as the supplies dwindled into the market due to the crisis, the domestic market started rallying. This is obvious, right? Beans are not coming. After the first wave, after the problems were solved initially, new supplies are not coming as easy as they were. And this was one of the major reasons that we decided also that we should now get into the market ourselves, because there is an upside here.
Correct.
It's not just anymore that you're selling into a hole. You are going to ride the market back up in the domestic market now, not internationally. So that sort of helped us a lot. Plus the fact that beans were tight locally by then. And the ones who were operating and who had the means of operating domestically, they walked away with absolutely phenomenal margins on the domestic market. So that was the takeaway, let's put it that way. A great way of, I mean, looking back now, it looks like it's fantastic that we could think along those lines in those times. It was absolutely stressful.
You
have ships like this stuck and forever you are on risk calls and lawyers, top management and finance guys, and everybody is mulling around your desk all the time. And you are continuously answering questions and not trading actually.
Yeah, so and then you're losing money on multiple fronts on, you know, on each cargo, right? The commodity prices are falling, the demurrages are rising, and you know, it just, and those are the, you know, top two, but then there are like multiple ways that it's just leaking, right? All over.
Exactly. So you're not really
money is leaking.
You're not in your trading seat anymore. You are in a firefighting mode all the time.
Correct.
On a daily basis. So that was something that that was very interesting as far as I could see.
Yeah, interesting looking back, Kazi. But going through, you know, you and I have been traders and we know what it is, you know, when we go through these kinds of things. So stressful for us, so stressful for the families and so on and so forth. So
in
fascinating,
fact,
fascinating
in
story.
Fact, yeah. In fact, some of the my colleagues in the industry who were the decision makers at that time for various companies, you know, it can be competition, whatever. But at the end of the day, we are all birds of the same feather.
Right.
So for them, 2003-04, the bean crisis is something that they wish to forget, because it was like they had ulcers, they had BP rising, there were all kinds of health issues. That was the time. So it's a but a lot of them also learned later and came back and did something differently.
So you said that, like, you know, what happened the following year and how you handled the market and developed the market was is a story by itself. So I'm sure we will, you know, have another, you know, interview with Kazi, and we would discuss what happened and how you rode that wave, I presume so. That would have been a wave. And so we would get an opportunity to discuss that rather soon, I suppose. Right?
Yep.
Thank you very much, Kazi. It was an excellent discussion. You know, thoroughly enjoyed it as always, right? And, you know, thanks for sharing your experiences and great learning for anyone, you know, who faces uncertain situations, volatilities in commodities, and then, you know, all of these leading to crisis. And then how do you stay calm, stay cool, you know, think of the options and, you know, and do some experiments, be ready to take some a little more risk and get some clarity and, you know, try out in the new opportunities and then develop them. And then, hey, crisis converted into an opportunity, right? Awesome.
Thank you, Kazi.
Thank you so much.
Yep.
Thank you for joining us in yet another episode of Move Conversations. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Please subscribe to the Move Conversations YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get notifications of new episodes. Thank you very much. Till I see you in the next episode. Thank you very much. Have a great day.